Yes, we can.
Four. We're waiting for.
We took the PL under.
We're waiting for.
The neighbor's lawyer screwed things up, so.
Trying to do so.
The neighbors. Botched up the dates.
So I was just saying to the other
point, you just go.
Let it go.
Waiting our fifth member, so we have four.
Like the next Tuesday, and then I'm putting this up with the date because I'm like, I'm not gonna caught a go.
Do you have a phone number for Frank?
Text him through Facebook.
Oh, Elaine, if you look on the town website, under planning board, it gives a whole list of the members, and if you hover over each name, it gives all their information, and oftentimes there is a phone number. I know my number's there.
Well, let's not take me to it.
I know. Another week I've got to go down to Florida, so my mother's house is full of men. We're cleaning it out to get everything, so taking all the family treasures on. She can't live alone anyway.
For we're looking for Frank Sabo.
Frank Durso.
Oh, Durso. How about the others? They're all no. They're not all not coming.
Sun City Center.
Yeah,
the first
one
was
there. Okay.
Isn't Frank Durso in a phone book?
Yeah, could be.
They used to be one in one of the. I bet the selectman's office has one in there.
Yeah, I've got one.
Jen, what a great introduction. We're not usually this way.
I was 1 minute late.
We feel like I'm on top of 1 minute late. Yeah, in fact, I need to talk to you real quick afterwards. The issue about, you know, the two towns had kind of been resolved because Ray Miaris sent a follow-up email where a lot of those questions he'd raised in the first one were removed. I guess they had gotten that resolved. I came all loaded with the information from Mass Planners and from some of the other towns and from CPC Coalition, but it was already addressed. But the thing with the signs, where they won't allow the signs, CPC was so mad that Sonnet said, let's put an article on town warrant to direct to fund it directly and let the people know that CPC's. I mean,
really?
It was kind of dumb.
Yeah. So they're putting a warrant.
I mean, when I think of they talked about it as creating history. It's not creating history. It's telling people what's there so that they value it and don't threaten it.
Like we talked about, yeah.
How many Civil War battlefields I've gone to. The sign's the only thing that tells you. If you didn't have the sign, you'd just put field. You know? Whatever. Man of the hour, Frank.
Don't have my scores, by the way.
Oh, you
did. Put signs up.
Good kid.
This is me. Finally.
Did
you get more space?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Something that gets the majority. Sounds like not too far.
Yeah.
Your son. Somebody just called.
Good, I know you. Okay. Okay, let's open the planning board meeting for Monday, March 14th, 2016. I'd like to thank HCAM for taping the meeting. Obviously, we are short several members today, so that being able to see the tape is going to be absolutely critical. If you're here for the 8:30 hearing for Pulte or Legacy Farms, it won't happen today. We don't have enough members for the Pulte public hearing, so that will get continued. So if that is the only reason you're coming, well, it'll have to be another night. We've got a lot of work to do tonight, and even with that 1 hour out, we're going to probably fill it up, and hopefully we'll be out right at 10. So anyway, let's get going with, let's start with taking one thing out of order, because I think we have Marie. Why don't you come on up here and let's talk about, we have some staff changes that I think the board members need to be aware of, and we'll talk about that for a second.
So. Great. Thank you.
Yeah.
Was Maria Casey, our HR director.
Hi, Maria.
Hi.
Were you looking for me to speak?
Well, Elaine, why don't you say what's going on?
There she is.
So I don't know if you are aware, but my position has changed a little bit. So I'm going to be land use director, but also take on some of the operational administrative functions from the town manager's office. So as part of that, and you know, continuing to serve the planning board, although I'd enjoy that, it would be quite a workload. So Jennifer Burke will be taking over the planning board staff. She's a professional planner just like I am. And knows everything I know.
not quite.
So, so I think we'll work on that together for a little while. We'll have a transition period, and gradually she'll be taking over the professional staff. I'll still be dealing with the zoning stuff, with Pulte, with Legacy Farms, that kind of thing. So the kind of at a higher level. So just wanted to let you know that you know those kinds of things are in the works, and I'll still be here and around, but. Gradually, I won't be attending planning board meetings, but for a while, I'll still be coming as needed.
But when we're having a hearing pertaining to legacy, you're not going to be here. You're just going to be doing legacy stuff in the background.
I'll come if I think it's important, uh-huh. If there's some major issues to talk about. So we'll play it by ear, and I don't mind coming for that. That's fine.
Good. Frank, go ahead.
I think you did a really good job this week, especially. Commentating, pulling together cross-department feedback on projects, and would your new role involve doing more of that?
Yes, so getting involved in more of the cross-jurisdictional and interdepartmental stuff, kind of pulling everything together, coordinating, that kind of thing, so on the land use side, and in other ways, too. It's something I'm interested in doing, and it's definitely a need of the town. I mean, we have so many moving parts, you know, coordinating all that and getting it all together is really important. And so it's exciting for me to kind of step into that role.
Congratulations.
Thanks.
Okay. Jennifer has very big shoes to fill. Don't you dare go anywhere.
Any other questions before I have a couple? A couple people have pointed out to me that our charter requires us to hire the planner, and you know, I've spent a lot of time with Jennifer, and I'm not having too much of trouble with that. I'm going to say it out front, but this board has the responsibility to hire a planner. When we hired Jennifer as a town, this board wasn't consulted in that because we weren't hiring her for a position that we had to hire. It was kind of done by Lane and her crowd, and you know, eventually I think we're going to be asked to vote on who the town planner is, as a, at least as a formality, but maybe not. And then the other question that somebody asked me to ask was, don't we have a policy that we need more than one candidate for a town office? But we're not necessarily going to go there, because I you know, but if other planning members would like to have a subcommittee to, or just to work on the job type of thing for a while and see how it works, I mean, that's the two ways that I see, you know, other people could have a, I won't say a search committee, but at least spend like the time that I did to maybe get, you know, interview her. I mean, but
that's fair.
That, I mean, I, you know, just be, so anyway, that's, anyone's thoughts on that?
Ken?
Yeah.
Can we ask Maria for her advice?
How so? I'm sorry.
His concerns about posting it and interview the process and organizationally, how does that work from your point of view?
Sure. you know, of course, it's all driven by the charter. One of the responsibilities that the charter imparts is posting of a position, and that posting is done for 10 days in accordance with the charter. So, you know, that's one of the requirements. I don't know, you know, kind of what Ken was speaking toward, you know, if it would be an open position versus a transfer or a promotion or, you know, getting into some of that, but...
Can I ask that?
I just wanted to mention, too, that the charter was written when there was only one planner, and now there's two planners, so things have changed, and so I think that there's a group looking at changes to the charter, so that might be something to consider. You know, the assumption was there was only one, but there's really two.
Go ahead.
Do titles change? I'm just trying to think of the legalistic. Do titles change or just the functions change?
My title change hasn't been town planner for at least 10 years. So I think when the charter was written, it was town planner, but very shortly thereafter, it became planning director. So it hasn't been town planner for a long time. And then changed again. So it's changed twice since town planner.
I mean, if we're not, are we following the charter rules and regulations, right, with what you've talked about here? It sounds like yes, but, I mean, is there any, are we missing anything here?
Well, from a functional thing, Elaine was approved when she was hired by the planning board as the town planner, I believe, is what the church says.
Singular. In 1992, that was the name of the position.
Yeah.
Right. So it's a kind of, the position's evolved, the charter necessarily hasn't.
Right.
I guess
which is under review as we speak on the 6th, on the year ending on 6th.
Yeah.
The charter is reviewed. The charter was approved in, I want to say, 2008. Okay. And so it's a lot of things are being looked at right now, logistically, functionally, you know, town meeting.
Yeah. It's just time for an overhaul. Yeah.
Okay.
And lastly, Jennifer, welcome more to the fold.
Thank you.
And from what I remember, you're from Hudson?
Correct.
And I remember your onboarding started like last fall or so that was...
June, yep.
Okay.
Yeah. Last June.
Well, almost a year ago.
Yep.
Well, does anyone feel that we have to put anyone through an interview process at this point, or do we just kind of let it go for a while and just give her... an on-board interview, and if we're happy after a while, we're all happy, or... I mean, we got to fulfill the
right,
charter.
Right. I mean, I'm okay with that as long as it's clearly kind of articulated and defined, that's what our process is going to be. Right,
that's why I'm asking the question,
I'm
exactly.
I'm totally fine with that.
Okay.
I'd be more comfortable waiting till at least our next meeting, so our other members who aren't here...
Oh, we're not going to do anything tonight.
Not sure what the outcome of that would be. I mean, we're already employed by the town at this point.
I
have been for a while.
I just, you know, it's just probably that might have been better to have had a couple of members of the board on when we hired her, from a practical standpoint.
Well, organizationally, Jennifer being hired was Elaine's called because she was
hired by the town manager.
Okay.
So most staff is hired by the town manager.
So
and recommended by you, correct?
Right. Yeah. So there was an interview process involving.
So correct me if I'm wrong. So organizationally, director of land use and planning, you oversee like say a Dominic Adam as well, or is he okay? So you all the three functions of the department.
Yes. Yeah. And that will continue.
And then, but for planning board purposes, your position that you've just moved or changed from, that position was hired by the planning board.
Well, when it was town planner back in 1992, it was hired by
the... So your town planner and other things.
Right.
And
so the position changed over the years and took on a lot more responsibility. Yeah.
So for the town planner portion of it, just like in Conservation Commission, Don McAdam is the administrator for conservation. For the town planner portion, specifically for the planning board, that's the part organizationally we have to see how.
There's a glitch there. Yeah.
Yep. Okay. I think we're kind of a mind to.
Just weighing in just very, very quickly, it's sounding from what Elaine has said that since the charter was created, the position has changed and evolved, and the staffing has changed in ways. And, of course, the entire time, well, since 92, Elaine's been here, so we haven't been involved in this type of decision because Elaine's been here forever.
Well, yes and no. I mean, when Elaine got,
we do the review.
When Elaine became the director of land use planning permitting, the planning board was asked to see whether she could take that on and not hurt her stuff. And we as a board came to the conclusion that it would actually make things better.
Right, right.
Which I think it has.
We did weigh in on that.
So the
but
board did vote to delegate its day-to-day authority to the town manager.
And we voted to delegate some day-to-day authority so that you know we're not signing Elaine's time cards and things like that.
Right. But it's kind of not an apples-to-apples thing from the position and responsibilities we're talking about now and what was created way back at the beginning of the. It sounds to me like if they are looking at the charter again, that it might be something going forward to be, you know, clarify the hiring guidelines and the procedures or, you know, exceptions to be made for promotions from within.
I'm not so sure that the planning board shouldn't hire the town plan.
I mean,
otherwise you might have a staff person that the nine of us here, you know, kind of their, I think it was a Framingham, had a Board of Health where the Board of Health guy was hired by the town manager, and then there was a fight between that board and the town manager, and that didn't do the people of Framingham any good.
Yeah.
And, you know, we're not looking to do any of that fighting, but on the other hand, You know, people working for you is part of the way you take on authority and delegate authority, and et cetera.
And hiring and firing is part of that.
And hiring and firing is part of that. Mm-hmm. Hopefully not any firing.
Right.
But just to clarify one more time, I don't mean to belabor it, but this is specifically the town planner portion of Elaine's responsibilities has now changing as being the primary town planner and shifting that to Jennifer because Elaine's responsibilities are growing and changing. And because the roles are the, well, Jennifer's roles are the same basically, but her responsibility is going to grow coming into this position. So what's our responsibility as a board to
I could see, you know, I could see a way if, say, if Elaine was coming every Monday that we meet and serving this, there would be, even though she's working 40 hours a week on everything else, you know, not a big deal. But we're shifting, as part of this, you know, the role, because otherwise it's not fair for Jennifer either, you know. I mean, Elaine's going into more, I'll say, supervisory type stuff, which is, you know, great for because that's what she's been studying for and everything else. But, you know, we're at the end of the day, we're going to have a new town planner responsible to this board to get things done. And right
but
now,
it sounds like there's two town planners, and then the primary role shifting to Jennifer. And that's
what we need to accept or not accept in sometime in the future.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it. Yeah.
Okay. Let's let that one go because we're already running into a late night as we go. I think the best thing would be then to open up the public hearing for Hehn's Farm. Thank you, Maria, for open up the public hearing for Hehn's Farm, Summit Realty Trust. As you've been informed, there's only five of us here. We're probably not going to conclude it tonight because I don't think we will, but if you were to, if there was a vote tonight, you'd have to have all five of us unanimously for it, and, but I don't think we're in a position to do a vote. But, so why don't we start with kind of a, I guess a modified outline here, where you kind of present the project to us. I know some members of the planning board have saw it in a preliminary form, I don't know, a few months ago, so, but there's a lot of people in the public that have not seen it. So let's start with an introduction for us, and then we'll start going through the issues.
Okay, great. My name's Joe Macquenot, joined by Brian Gassett. Brian is the applicant. We are the designers. I brought a couple of boards that I've never been referred to.
Right here.
Hope you all can see that. You may recall, the members of the board, we were here with an informal discussion with this group to discuss this particular parcel July 27th and talk in a very general nature about how to move this thing forward. This is the Hehn property. It's 8.1 acres. It's parcel on the easterly side of Ash Street. It's been in the Hehn family since the early 60s. Mr. Hehn passed on a short time ago, and the family has disposed of it, and Brian has purchased it, I think, sometime back in January. There's an existing home here, circa 1779. A barn that is accessed by gravel and paved driveway right in this location. The intent is still the same with that. That is going to remain. That home is going to remain in, well, I think Brian hopes to update it, but as part of this proposal, we're going to retain number 25 Ash Street. The parcel has about 179 feet of frontage along Ash Street. It's a funny shape. We are bounded on the northerly, easterly, and southerly lines, boundary lines by stone walls. It's abutted by the property of the Camborellis is here, whose home is at the front, and the rear is the Todd of Hopkinton School Department. That is the backside of the center school. Easterly is other land that the town acquired as open space from the Prestwick Estates subdivision, and then back along the southerly side are members of the Remby and Holland families. They created a subdivision road here, Catherine Drive, that you see here on the bottom side. You may recall that we spent an awful lot of time back in July talking about the proximity of this parcel. What this allows is a link between the town property at the center school through other lands owned by the town of Hopkinton all the way to Legacy Farms. So this would allow a corridor for whatever purpose, trails, hiking, motorized vehicles, what have you, a natural swath of protected land. This is a linchpin to creating that corridor. The parcel is bisected about the center by a power easement. The Hehns granted rights to what at the time was Boston Edison, now Eversource. They retain the land, but there is an easement over it, which differs from some of the other parcels in the area where Eversource owns that land in fee. The key to this is the fact that on the easterly side of that easement is the RB zone district. To the westerly side is the RA zone district. All our work is focused here on the westerly side. It's a gently sloping area, moderately to gently sloping, that runs from Ash Street in a westerly direction. It's got a lot of uses associated with what was a residential use for 50 years. It's got fields, overgrown gardens, it's got some landscaped areas. It's really quite attractive. The westerly side beyond the power easement is almost completely forested. It's more steeply sloped and again runs away to the east. Our proposal is very similar materially to what you saw back in July. for the same orientation, Ash Street is out in here. Here's the existing home. We're going to create three new lots. Lot 1 will be around the existing number 25. It's a 26,723 square foot parcel, which is well above the 15,000 square foot minimum that we need. And much of that lawn area, landscaped areas, will go with Lot 1. Lots 2 and 3 are here in the rear. Lot 2 being 26,710, again over the 15,000. And Lot 3 is the largest at 32,949. We have four parcels, not lots, that are associated with the project. Parcel A was chiefly for stormwater. Difficult to incorporate into those lots, so it has do it as a separate parcel, and chiefly its function is to house the stormwater controls. Parcel B is this strip along the northerly boundary line against the proposed roadway. We're going to keep that for the use of the homeowners association, as we are intended to be a private way. That piece would be for whatever uses those folks deem appropriate. Screening, snow storage, maintaining it in a natural state. The other two are the lands that are going to go to the town of Hopkinton. Parcel C creates that link that I mentioned a moment ago. It's how you get from the town property out to easterly to the rest of the land. And parcel D is the 4.8 acres that is the bulk of the property west of the power line. So those two, C and D, will go off to the town. The access to lots 2 and 3 will be over the right-of-way Parker's Lane, which is shown here. That's a 40-foot wide right-of-way. It's just a shade under 444 feet long, 443.96. What we are asking the board to entertain are waivers to the construction standards so that we build what is, in essence, a 12-foot wide bituminous driveway. We've included one spot in here, 25-foot long, for a turnout to facilitate travel back and forth. The vehicles can pass one another on that roadway. But that's what we're after, is this long driveway I've highlighted in gray to access those two well below the minimum width, something more appropriate to what we feel this is, a less complicated, less complex design. As I said a moment ago, if you see fit to grant those waivers, I think it's in keeping with the fact that this will remain a private way. We'll have a bitcong surface, a paved surface here. What we've chosen to do is not crown the driveway, but instead super elevate the left-hand side, the northerly side, so that it's a few inches higher than the right-hand side, and all that water will flow back onto the site. What we're attempting to do is sheet flow that storm water and run it all the way down easterly to this catch basin, this modified catch basin here. Not the traditional frame and grade cover, but a drop inlet so the water can enter in through all sides of that. That's the start of our stormwater attenuation. We'll pipe it to a grass swale here into this detention basin, and ultimately the outlet is here on the southeasterly corner. It's given the limited nature of construction, it's not a big basin. I think the cut is probably 2 foot from existing grade on the westerly side. We get the storage by building up the easterly side. We build the slope up, put the access berm in there, then drop down to existing grading through here. So it's not a dramatic change in elevation associated with that basin. With all of our stormwater attenuation, we're able to meet the standard that the pre and post development numbers for stormwater rate and flow are at or below pre-existing condition. So the stormwater should help us, the element should help us control our stormwater. A couple of the other hot button issues that normally pop up. Utilities will come from Ash Street. Power is coming in along the northerly side. Municipal sewer on the southerly side. and municipal water under the surface, just north of the center line of the driveway. We sought out permission and approval and received approval from John Westling, Director of Public Works, for a connection to municipal water and sewer. Number 25 already enjoys connections, and they'll maintain those. The new ones will be for lots 2 and 3. With regard to fire protection, there is an existing hydrant here at the opposite side, the westerly side of Ash Street, out in front of number 25. Ryan is going to introduce fire suppression for both lots 2 and 3 in the rear to provide protection to those two homes. Site distance, the posted speed limit here in Ash Street is 25. We have sufficient site distance in both directions if we do some brush clearing, just some low brush here as you look southerly along Ash Street. So site distance will be achieved once that clearing takes place. The wetlands we have on the site, wetlands resource areas that are under the jurisdiction of the Conservation Commission, are here along the northerly side. Their source is the stormwater controls in Ash Street. That is piped from that series of manholes and catch basins across the Camborellis land, across the Hehn land, and deadheads out in here. There's a intermittent stream with associated bordering vegetated wetlands that flows easterly away from Ash Street through a series of channels and poorly constructed piping. So that wetlands area is of some concern to the Conservation Commission. We're off next Monday night, the 21st, to meet with the commission to have them weigh in on the accuracy of that delineation and give us some element of a request for determination. We assume a positive that the wetlands is accurate and that the buffer zone is accurate. The key to that is our basin is just south of that buffer zone area. So we don't anticipate any troubles, but we are before them next week to tie all that down. I mentioned a moment ago, we have our DPW approvals, and obviously the homes will have to seek out building permits from inspectional services to make sure that the designs are fine and that they meet all the front, side, and rear setback requirements. That's a brief introduction on a lot of topics. I'd be glad to go into more depth on anything that you see fit. I know there's also some feedback from other review agencies and a letter from Beta that we could touch on as well. Claire?
Just clarifying on your drawing there, Joe, you show the bulb at the end of the roadway. Are you doing the bulb, or is it just a straight driveway?
Straight driveway, Claire. The gray down into here.
Oh, so if the bulb goes away, then?
The bulb is here to create frontage to make these legal lots.
But you're not doing a turnaround.
Waive the construction standards down to a 12-foot wide surface.
Okay, so there is no turnaround.
Correct.
Correct.
One of the things we may want to require, both of these driveways have a hammerhead kind of built into the, mm-hmm. the driveway, and maybe that right. might be something that in lieu of the cul-de-sac type bulb require that they be built in a hammerhead, you know, because people need to be able to turn around.
It just reading over the materials beforehand with the kind of waivers you're asking and the fact that it's only servicing two house lots and ongoing problems the town has experienced with private ways that eventually don't become private ways. You know, it just looks to me like this is a good candidate to just be a common driveway, not a way, but that's my feeling.
So I think one of the things we're being asked to determine today. Okay, other questions of the board? I've got a few that...
Yeah, one question. What is the width of parcel B, right? The distance between the driveway and the abutter's property line?
Approximately? Ballpark. 10 feet?
10 feet.
It's on the design plan. They can narrow it down if you'd like.
Other questions? Okay, I've got a couple. The parcel A owner is going to be eventually the association?
The association.
Okay, so in the homeowners association consists of the two houses that have to maintain the common driveway.
That was my assumption.
Yes.
Okay.
That was correct.
Okay, and B is also the association?
Yes.
Okay. Don't we have a Parker something street in town?
Parker Point.
Parker Point. I don't know whether you're going to get in trouble with the fire or police folks on that
possibility. Name. Mm. I knew about Parker Point, but I didn't know if the Parker Lane was.
Is there a Parker connection to that?
Yeah, it's close enough.
It was my mother's maiden name, and I have a very close uncle, and his last name's Parker. Okay.
Hehn Lane has a nice ring to it.
I did name it, you know, Hehn Farm, so after the matter of fact, I got a nice call from that. And I'm not opposed to doing that.
Before you start.
You always fight me with no matter what I name it.
That's
anyway.
Not true, Brian. Well, no, we don't want to add more.
We're not the name folks, but I know you're probably putting that on a lot of plans.
Yeah. And his mother's first mentor in heaven, the Helen Parker Road.
Yeah, I don't know. They give you a hard time with full names, maybe.
I just caution you on it. That's all.
Yeah, well, that's an easy thing to. We have to look into that anyway.
And then the two other questions I had, kind of based on the opening presentation, the sewer connection.
Low pressure sewer, correct.
Are you doing two pipes out to the street or one?
One.
So basically the two are going to be tied together.
Yep.
Okay.
Too small for me, I couldn't.
And the outlet that you have for your pond, your the stormwater pond, why did you not connect that into the wetland to the north as opposed to putting it to the south? I don't know really what's on the eastern property per se, but what I'm my question is if we've created a wetland on parcel
C
or whatever, we have
runs through C. Yeah.
Well, I'm looking at it from the future value of the town. You know, it's much more valuable as a upland resource as opposed to creating more wet. If you know, I don't know what it looks like, but you know, is it possible to run the, I'm sure it's possible because it's going downhill, the water is going to eventually get one way or the other, but would it be better to keep one intermittent stream more healthier than creating another possible intermittent stream? Or maybe you're going to tell me it's only going to overflow once in a blue moon, because it's going to...
I think it depends on the volume of flow coming out of it. You know, and now you're trying to tie that into our...
But the road is going to create a volume of flow, isn't it?
Yeah. Cliff? No. So, that's one of my questions, I guess, is you know, I don't want to diminish the parcel D by creating more water that might not be there today, you know, channelized water such that we now have a new wetland area on parcel D that goes off to the east. And
I guess the first thing that strikes me, Mr. Chairman, is the fact that I imagine there'd be real concerns about changes in the flow of the existing stream channel through here, adding more water in those storm events that require that the water flow through the outlet is going to have an impact on the natural state of that wetlands.
Yeah, but
I could see there'd be some real resistance changing flow characteristics in that existing wetlands, whatever the source.
Well, I see right now it's just easier to put another outlet over in the other spot, and since you don't care about the property downstream so much, you know, I don't know.
Yep.
I'm going to leave that one off to our friends at the Beta to kind of ponder that. Maybe I'm being unrealistic about it, but...
The other issue that pops up is the fact that there is a ledge outcrop, a large boulder covered by very little soil right through here. So we would have to find some way to meander around that to reach that location. So we may be introducing more site work rather than less.
Okay. One of the action items is for you guys to tell me how much water is going to go out that outlet and what type of an equate, you know, if it's once in a blue moon, maybe I don't care.
Yeah, I think it'd be helpful, Andy, if we went out and just, could we get back there and take a look?
Absolutely.
Yeah, I think it'd be helpful to do that. And, yep. And my initial reaction is I don't think it'd be a whole lot of water that you're talking about. There's not a huge amount of impervious that you're actually creating with the plan. And the roofs are going to direct to ground?
Or are they direct going to ground.
Yeah,
direct,
okay, direct. So you're taking out that impervious
too. It's quite dry out back there. Do you know that?
Pardon me?
It's quite dry out back. It's only in the front part that it's very wet. And there's springs there.
Okay.
We'll have
so and particularly you're going to Concom next.
Yeah.
That would be kind of maybe.
We'll also have to review our rights with regard to the easement for construction activities. Boston Edison had a very strong lobby, still does. This was a very strong lobby. We may be limited in what can take place through here.
In the past, I had a problem with any activity at all in here, but easement, even though it's our property in this particular case.
You should be able to go underground.
Think there might be pushback.
Yeah. Claire?
Yeah, just on the subject of that detention, too, I'm noticing Board of Health's comments about subsurface based on standing water and mosquito issues. Now, it's a small site, and I know this lady's now saying it tends to be dry, but, you know, I don't know if subsurface would be warranted, but there is growing concern, you know, with mosquito issues that kind of would point to trying to do something underground rather than standing water, if possible.
Generally, what we find, Claire, is they're slightly larger to go underground.
Yeah.
And at this location, with Brian's reputation as a tree conservationist, to spend more money, to be larger, to cut more trees, is certainly not something that a road we want to head down.
Mm. Except there are no trees on the easement.
Correct, but we are west of the easement.
Right, I understand. Okay, then that my final issue that I'd like to bring up because it kind of ties into the conversation. Do members want to do a site walk on this property anytime soon? I've walked it back when the school was thinking about it, so I don't have to go, and I know I'm not around this weekend, and I don't know what the weather's going to be like this weekend, but if other members wanted to do, maybe Saturday morning would be good.
Either that or because it's a small enough site and it's right uptown, if it's possible, I think Brian did this with Cobbler's Way, staking the lots so that we could go in, if not with an organized, you know, site.
It's, it's everyone's preference. Because like I said, I've seen it, so I'm good.
Yeah, but knowing a site is always good.
And I
can meet anybody out there at any point, obviously.
Can put some lot stakes in or something, just some little orange things like lot one, lot two, kind of.
Roughly give you an idea, sure.
I'm available this weekend. So I'm available and always looking for good walks. But
it'd probably be a good walk.
I'm not available this weekend. I am familiar because with the site. Going back to when we're looking at the library and that area, so I have looked at that.
Okay, so Elaine, why don't you or Jennifer send out an email to the planning board and we'll post it. If you get significant number, meaning probably more than the two.
Two or three.
Yeah.
I signed up for the dumb planning conference. You can only do so much planning on one weekend.
Yeah, okay. Well, maybe. Maybe we end up, you know, it doesn't have to be this weekend. You know, give them a couple options, like maybe the following weekend.
Self-guided.
Okay, so how do we want to proceed now? We've got a bunch of issues that we've got to get through. I'm going to assume all the stormwater issues will get done between Beta, the Conservation Commission pretty much, and the engineers all talking. So I don't want to spend so much time on that. We want to hit the elephant in the room, and that's parcel B, because I believe we have a letter from the abutter's lawyer on that. And so we hit that one first, because that one changes everything if people aren't in the consensus on that mode. So, do you want to present what
you...
Sure.
Can I settle up here?
Oh, please do.
Okay. Good evening. My name is Michael Fee. I'm from Pearson Mandel in Boston. I represent Diane Camporellis. You should have my letter that was submitted last week, and it outlines the basic objection we have with respect to the requested waiver for Parcel B. But before I get to that, I just wanted to raise a concern when you started talking about common driveways. I know, and it's the first time I've heard about this design. I wasn't aware that you were intending it to be a common driveway in this configuration, and I just would highlight for the board the fact that there is a zoning provision on point that requires that common subdivisions serving two parcels, and that's 210-120. And I haven't considered it yet. I'll research it, but I think you might want to just take a look at that issue before assuming that a common driveway is allowable zoning on this design. So, with respect to the requested waiver, obviously, parcel B, basically the argument, and it starts with the fact that the subdivision regulations are fairly clear as to what the purposes are. They set forth provisions whereby the planning board is required to design streets with respect to that aren't yet subdivided. And Mrs. Camporellis has a property that is very subdividable, and she in fact intends to subdivide in the future. It's a two parcel, and it's this zoning district. It's clear that she could have one or two or maybe three lots accessed by driveways off of the proposed part. I think that your regulations are fairly clear in the sections 82 and 821 that the plan to lay out streets in a way so that they're abutting neighbors, if in fact it's appropriate and good planning. And I would suggest to you that in this instance, provisions that prohibit reserve streets called spite strips are very common. They're in almost all zoning bylaws and subdivision regulations. And the purpose of it is to really to eliminate duplication of effort. If this Mrs. Camporellis was able to vision, she would build another road exactly like the road that's being proposed, and you would have down Ash Street, these three mirror image paper streets that add impervious surface, that limit site distance. And from that perspective, I would suggest to the board that it makes sense, when possible, to coordinate that in such a way that would benefit the Camporellis. So that's what's driving it from our standpoint, and we think defensible, especially with respect to your regulation, which is unambiguous. You know, reserve strips are prohibited. Discretion, you determine that in the public interest. And there is guidance in your regulations as to what constitutes a determination that public interest is served. And the bar is quite high. There's no definition of what constitutes being public interest, but if you read the purposes section of the regulations, it's quite clear. It talks about eliminating congestion, making roads safe, health, welfare, all of these very standard planning principles that must be considered in terms of what constitutes the public interest. I don't know, but it seems that Parcel B has been designed in such a way so as to deny Ms. Camporellis' ability to access a bridge that would to her. And I suggest to you that there's no discernible public interest that's served by that design. There's also a second requirement not only that the waiver be in the interest, lost my train of thought for a moment here, but also consistent with the intent of the subdivision regulation. So I would suggest to you again, if you look at the purpose, which is language in the subdivision regulations that, that can give you that gloss, is served by this design other than create a of privacy for the applicant. And I think that the planning board should look in a broader you will approach to this particular development, integrate it into the neighborhood in a way that serves everyone's interests. So that's my presentation. Happy to answer questions.
Okay. Probably just some questions, and I'm not so sure I'm advocating this position, but I'm just going to ask them so that you need to kind of help either defend it or whatever. You talked about a benefit. Should your then be required, I'll say half the road, if we take a driveway of limited width, bring it up to standard road ability? Or if she would like to do that in the future, would that be a cost?
Right.
Right now, if we approve it as presented, it's a common driveway. We do allow common driveways in Hopkinton for up to only two lots. And
no.
There's only two that are served by that.
Lot subdivision. So I'm just playing it from a legal standpoint. I think that you could argue that there's
three lots. I just would caution everybody to recall that we are a subdivision road, common drive. We're waiving construction standards to construct something less than the rural road, the 21-foot width, catch basins and manholes. We are subdivision road purpose.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Answer your question. I mean, I haven't spoken to my client, but I think it's a legitimate ask, and certainly something worth discussing.
I mean,
because if she's benefit from it, then
also implies some cost. Because I mean, to build it to a standard that you'd have to build it for a three lot is significantly more than what.
Agreed.
Okay.
I have a question.
Yeah, go ahead.
See this. I don't see a problem with privacy being one of the goals for either neighbor, for either side of the situation, but in the long term, now, planning board and neighborhood, what would we'd like this to look like, and talk in advance of coming here, get out together, doing it here.
I did reach out to Mr. Gassett. I haven't heard from him, so discussion at some point.
What's the front in your client's property?
I don't know. Off the top of my head. 140? And I off the top of my head.
Maybe Elaine, you can just look at a plan. The question is really, could there be another, I'll say, small cul-de-sac to serve back property, but there's a difference, though, in that we have a long-standing no cul-de-sac unless there's circumstances, of which it's been our policy that exceptional circumstances include the gift of land in the town of Hopkinton. You know, that was what we kind of talked about last July is the area where we would even kind of even entertain that, and you know, because we can build get from one parcel to the other, that made that attractive to the members when we met last July, because right now we do not have a to get across the Boston as easement, where they own it in fee, where the town property is. So I guess, you know, the real question is there, well, first of all, I'm not so sure with 2 acres that there's a gift of land that could be made on the other side. So I'm not sure whether we'd go for that. I have turned down 2 acres, not in that area, but where somebody wanted to basically do a backlot zoning type.
I don't think we would need a cul-de-sac, per se. Vision for this would be 2 tasteful openings in the stone wall with driveways leading into lots on our property.
Sure, using the road that's Parker's Lane that's created on.
Correct.
It would be no frontage.
So, and you need 100 stairs in Resi. And so you technically could get a road back there,
absolutely.
I would think.
They have the same.
As I was mentioning, I mean, paper streets going right down the road, I guess that's a decision that the board needs to make. I'm only suggesting that if the parties can share under whatever conditions that agree upon, I think everybody wins. That's at least our position.
Well,
more coordinated.
We're going to settle this one tonight, and I think maybe we leave this with parties to talk about, you know, and see if there's conversation that can be going on, and then if there isn't, then we'll have to really figure out which way we want to go with this. But, you know, if you're doing 3 houses, it's going to be a bigger road than the driveway type.
Do we have any, Mr. Chairman, do we have precedent here?
Well, we have we have precedent on Catherine, it's shown on the plans, which is right next to it. We also have McDermott Lane, where we did.
Correct.
It was done years ago, maybe, at this point. Basically, they put the bulb, they saved the historic house in the front, they gave some land back to the town. Their trail constructed a common driveway as opposed to a road up to subdivision standards. So that would be the precedent that would be, I think.
Separate houses. I wasn't going to open up into, you know, 4 more.
Yeah, and we, the town took, I'll say, the spite strip or whatever it as a trail. It goes from EMC Park to their trail area. I guess that's the precedent area. Any other good questions?
Lane, because if you can remember the details, I cannot remember the details of the back lot zoning proposal years ago that went down in at town meeting for of opening up developable land. I'm not sure how, you know, into that same issue of backlog.
That it would open up land for development that might be developed.
Right. I mean, I know we've done, you know, a few common drives when there's an exceptional chance of a valued connection to other. And sort of overshadows, you know, some of our other prohibitions. But I don't know. It's a conundrum because I understand use their land, and yet it seems like we're very bit by bit chipping away into the same accessing land that normally not accessible because there isn't frontage. So I'm not expressing. Either way, I'm just stating what I'm wrestling with right now, that this is all backlot land development without frontage.
And in a very visible.
Yeah. I'm not so sure you're gonna, from a visibility, you're gonna see those 2 houses very much at all. see that out. It's well, it's another driveway that you can see from Ash Street. That's what I think you. I mean, if you in there or an 18 foot or whatever driveway, I think it'd be more visible than what you're going to see with a more or less a driveway. But that's, you know, some of us like. But.
Well, I'm hoping the board sees it the way we have it, because the way the gift that's given to the town, we've done the work for the drainage, for the size of the right-of-way that we have. You know, I have clients that I you know, would like to get going on this, and I mean, to redo it now and change all the drainage and get into all this work now, it's just...
That's the first night of the hearing.
No, we've been...
Well, I... You know, I would... You might... You might... You know, it's not to say... Because the board has approved similar... I'm not saying that we aren't going to... But... Got in front of us an argument, and... maybe you're a butter who is going to make life more miserable for you than not. It's threatened in the letter. Lawyers don't threaten, they advise us that they'll take. So, so anyway. So, anyway. Yes, Chuck.
Mr. Chairman, could the board weigh in on their thoughts with regard to constructing a full road in there with the potential five houses coming out of both from a public safety standpoint and a congestion standpoint, which are two of the standards for what you should be looking at in terms of...
From a congestion standpoint, I don't think you can make an argument from an engineering standpoint in the middle of our downtown, and particularly with Center School going away in about 2 years, this is going to be a... And I... On Ash Street, I don't think that lots are going to...
And in further reinforcing what was a couple of years ago, what was approved for McDermott, which is identical circumstance. People can donate a land to the town and back. The road was waived to a two-lot driveway. The parcel on the left. To me, it's the board has already acted in good faith, and it has worked out very
well.
McDermott didn't open up the possibility for any more lots, though. It was quite limited.
But that's what I'm saying. The common drive does not limit it to two house lots.
I will, you know, there are some arguments that debunk forward, and we'll probably. All I'm suggesting, we spend some. You guys all spend some time talking a little bit, and figure out where you want to go.
We're happy to do that.
It, you know, it. We might be right back there. You know, until you kind of solve that one. You know, then we know from an standpoint which way to go. You know, quite frankly, if you're going to, but you know, there ought to be some compensation or, you know, more. It's just my opinion that you're going to need to work out amongst yourselves first. I don't know much beneficial. How are you on the state?
I think most of our review hinges on that central question. Okay. Our concern would be if this is an approved subdivision right-of-way that will eventually be an accepted street, we have concerns with how the street's designed. If it's meant as a common driveway worth of street standards, but I wouldn't want to see this being accepted way out of the current design.
No, we would definitely put in decision that this is a public way or anything else, because it truly is not up to our current standard.
Correct. Some of the other concerns on some stuff, as you mentioned, I think that can be worked outside of this discussion. Have to go through it if it's worthwhile.
Most of the drainage stuff, it's better for you, the engineers, to talk back and figure that out. Hopefully a relatively clean thing. Some of the waivers that were requested, which was a half a page, a lot of them really get issues. It's a common, you know, some of the granite curbing and things like that, you know, we don't, wouldn't require. Some of the kind of process stuff, you know, address of the paperwork address, we'll probably want most. I don't know. I guess I can give to, and board members are happy with that.
Okay. I'm a little bit needed if there are two houses. But, you know, I'm open to whatever you guys work out.
Well, I mean, you're going to have a common landowner, and they have a spot to can pass if you're coming out at each other, and, you know, it's...
Same as McDermott's, isn't it?
Yeah. Same with McDermott. We did... So, yeah. With... Now have a little... easier maneuverability with our current design.
Sure.
But you'll see, you break out the McDermott plans, they look, you're this.
When do we continue it to, Elaine? Jennifer? I don't know which one I prefer to these days.
Probably not till April 11th. Pulte is hoping for it March 28th. April 11th, we have a public hearing for zoning, public hearing for street. That's it.
I will not be here April 11th, so whether it's important that there's only... There'll be four.
April 25th after that.
Well, I could watch the tape.
Yep. Let's go for the 11th. We have... the athletic parcel and the street continues?
The amendment that's to change the Osmond to uses.
Yep.
So it starts at 6:30, we haven't put an end time on that, and then the continuance, 10th, if the that to you. But that can happen anytime. In there just in case.
Okay, why don't we do it at 8 o'clock on the 11th? Looking for a motion for 8 o'clock on the 11th. Is that okay for you guys?
So moved.
Second.
Seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote? Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you very much.
Okay. I saw Mr. McDowell working around. Did you, let's do a couple other things while we're waiting to see if he's around. How about the approval not required box mill?
They're waiting, just waiting to hear what the continuance date is for.
Oh.
It's just the butters.
Okay.
No.
Okay. Let's do the approval not required plan. You got the plans?
Yep. I'm sorry.
This is the same plan that we've seen before.
It's the same plan that you approved the portion of the plan, right?
rather than the whole set, so it's just the ones that create the lots.
So basically, I think everyone understands what the plan was. Mm-hmm. This is the plan. Okay. Look for in our standards. Look for a motion to sign and approve the approval not required plan for Box Mill Road.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Okay.
Here, and I don't know where they are right now. But there's some questions, and I told them to ask Elaine and how it's going to fit. And I don't see how any to anyone. Is this the one?
It's the same plan of water.
Yeah. Exactly what?
Right, well, so it's four sheets because it's only the sheets that create the lots. So it's only the approval not required portion.
Only the lots, not the row specifically.
The construction detail we approved for you previously. Right.
The four sheets that we have really necessarily show. The lots themselves aren't changing of...
They are not changing.
It's the road itself. So that's...
No. What it's been forever. The thing is, they're doing is drawing the lines down here.
So it's creating
the lots. The lots along an existing right-of-way.
But, I don't know. They've called you as well. And there's some people here, so...
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it's been on the old maps.
In that area.
It doesn't, you know. If we don't sign it in 15 days, it's approved by the town. We have a motion and a second. And we need 5 votes to sign? Mm-hmm. All those in favor of signing the
discussion.
Okay, go ahead.
How many days is it that it automatically? 15?
21 days from the date it's submitted.
It was peak. I don't know. You guys are there. They came, so they're let me just grab them.
There's no meeting next door.
Talk about the construction of the road and to explain why the right isn't needed any ease of right away isn't needed anymore for the easement. I don't know.
There was an easement required on the earlier version of the plans, and when they shifted the road, it didn't need an easement anymore. It was totally within the right of way, so it didn't need an easement on a.
Right,
so
it was just shambles, and they
right.
moved
so
it over
totally
the corner.
Within the existing right-of-way, so it didn't need any abutters.
So how wide is the road?
It's the same right-of-way it always was, 1800s or whenever it existed. And the roadway is within that, like 20 feet or so.
It just fits? So and
it
then
fits.
It fits.
It fits.
And the founding, and it was for some improvements and some, it's fairly flat out there, but they were able to shift that out. They aren't going to interact with the abutters property. Everything within the right of way. And that was on the plan that the board approved.
Right, that was like 11, 8 and a half by 11, or legal size paper, whatever. And
the size that you get. You can go
True.
See these anytime at the planning office because Elaine's got them. She just can't mail them out and reproduce them here.
True. I'm just saying.
And on your computer, you can look as big as you really want to get.
It doesn't answer the question, but that's not intended to answer the question. But
this is to draw lot lines.
And there's no easement shown, so there's no property. They can't touch the abutters property.
Nobody loses. None of the abutters lose. a square inch of any property.
Right, and they can't touch it.
It all can.
Right. So it's gonna take that one basin off of Alicia's property and put it onto the town right away. You might want to say it's actually better.
I thought that plan was next.
No.
Her catch basin stays.
Does it stay?
And they don't interact with it.
Oh. Okay, it stays, but they have another one next to it.
I thought there was just one.
Yeah, it was, I guess.
Plan here with us. This one doesn't show those details.
But basically, when you have a plan that now conforms and meets all, there's really denial because there's not any not complying with.
And it was a pre-existing way.
Right.
Yeah.
Naughty to right. Do the authorization because we have no grounds to refuse.
And the things I'm unhappy about were things they didn't have to do, but there were handshake agreements we did on the walkthrough that they said we're going to put fences, and then he's putting fences everywhere, but one he didn't agree with what he wanted to do. He's not putting a fence. So that's a handshake thing that he didn't want to do.
Well, no. The handshake was a deal that didn't get to the last step. She refused to sign the easement that allowed him.
Well,
and when she refused to sign the easement, refused and chose not, it's the same damn word, Frank.
Didn't sign it.
Quite frankly.
Wow. I heard from the developer what to do for the neighborhood to make everyone happy.
Provided that the neighbors agreed to do certain other things. Refused. Spent more money on catch basins and other things. Not that I want to defend the guy, but got to get to Faxon Road.
He's been responsive. The facts are that we went on the walkthrough and he said they're going to put fences, and I think, my opinion, it was a spiteful, type of spite. It's the opposite. He's not putting a fence despite that she didn't want to agree to do this, because why for something she didn't understand have to get a lawyer for, and too complex to deal with. I think I just made up my mind. I'm going to vote no. Because he didn't have to do the fences, but he said he would.
He said he would do the fences if she gave him an easement.
I'm not.
She said
deal.
No.
Who said what? He said...
That's what he said in public testimony.
There. I'm unhappy with it.
This will be the first of an A&R required that
sure.
We've never signed. And it's going to be signed whether you like it or not by the town clerk in another 2 weeks.
What I'm saying is that I don't understand, and people have asked me, I can't explain it well enough to them.
Well, then, Elaine, come to me and I will be happy to explain. I have not gotten any requests from anyone for it, and I do to all my phone calls. But, I mean, you know, you have some responsibility, in my opinion, of what we normally try to do. And we're approving an A&R plan. Instead of spending 20 friggin' minutes on something 2 minutes in the agenda.
I think it's important to think about how you would defend the action if it were appealed. Based on the standards for approving approval not required plans, which is it meets the.
But what my point is, and maybe I was being flip saying I'm not going to sign it, but my point is that on the walkthrough, on our private time on the weekend, the been pretty responsive on this, said I'm putting fences here because the neighbors, and I want the neighbors to be happy with what I'm doing, and blah, blah, blah. And that's the part where you have to do that. And then that's the part I...
The part you didn't hear is I will put the fence in and I will give the neighbor another piece of land provided that she gives me the corner as an easement.
But that's between him and the neighbors.
Well, and you deal or you don't take the deal.
Right. But
so she decided she didn't want the extra land and didn't want the fence he was building because she didn't want to give up the corner.
I feel like I need to explain why this. The other neighbors didn't have that situation. Two neighbors had the situation that we're talking about, the two abutters to this new road. The other neighbors still get fences, and they're not abutters. He did about the construction to make it smoother and to make it a nicer presentation, and everyone's getting the fences there except for the one neighbor who's an abutter of the road because he wasn't happy with the other arrangements he's trying to make out. The fence arrangements, in my mind, were a whole other thing in order to make construction time more pleasant for the abutters.
You know, if I can just... What's done is done. There's a disagreement between the neighbor and the developer, but the standards for are very, very small and pretty, and they have been met. And so argue somebody else's little bone to pick till we're blue. The argument is not germane required for this board to approve an approval plan.
But
it's agreed. Not related.
Someone's
bone
to pick for us is someone else's major thing. Next to your house when there's a and there's more people living there. About. I want the neighbors to be happy. I want the new neighbors to be happy with when they go into some place that's built, and I want everyone to get along.
I understand, Frank. You always support the neighbors, and that's a real value, but it's important to understand the proper jurisdiction of this board or and if it is met and other issues are not under our purview for this type of a plan. And right.
And is this an issue? There's only five of us here today?
No.
But if it looks like that you will not get a motion approved, take no action. That way the town clerk can sign it. If there's a vote to not endorse, it will be appealed, and that's you go the legal route.
Well,
so I would recommend that you just take let the time expire, sign it, because if you vote no...
Well, we wouldn't be voting no. We would be voting.
Well, if there's a motion to endorse,
it won't pass.
I'm saying what Ken's saying. I'm not saying endorse, not endorse. I'm just saying
no action.
No action. I guess that's what I was thinking more than what you're thinking. I'm not even really thinking that. My only point is,
I don't want to have legal expense over this small piece. So, I'd like you to withdraw the motion that came about. If that's it, no, we'll take no. Yes, there was.
Yes, sir.
Just don't make a motion at all. Just let the time expire.
There are already motions.
No, you can withdraw. Do I hear a withdrawal of the motion?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. So motion has been withdrawn, so we have no motion on board. Okay, let's... Let's... Which one are you guys waiting for?
And there were people to hear from the
state. Scary.
Okay. Okay, if you're just having fun, that's okay.
Danger.
Let's go down until we get to closer. E.L. Harvey, 394 Wood Street. This is some minor modifications to the building. And this is the demolition or whatever it is. Construction demolition, I guess it is. Construction and demolition recycling building.
Coming?
This was, and we have it in the packet, C&D processing building. Well, actually, I think Elaine's memo showed. They were changing loading area slightly and a few other minor changes. Building as it is, it's an industrial-type building. Here it is, it's on page 16 of Elaine's memo. Raising the finished floor elevation by 2 feet, relocating the trailer pit to the southwest to the northwest, a couple of storm
to get relocated, and then move the shipping and receiving loading dock to southwest to northwest. Change the overhead door, add a canopy over the dock area. Not visible from wood.
That's the important piece.
Changes are minor. It's way in the heck in the back. So, number one, people, this is something that we're ready to approve today. If we decide that we can approve an administrative today, the vote, then we'll have to have a public.
Can I just ask a question? I remember when this resigned, the Zoning Board of Appeal had interminable hearings to the point that they basically designed the whole site. I seem to recall that any changes ended up having to go back. That
so
still
in the decision they gave the zoning officer the ability to approve minor changes, and they have approved these.
So it's already been signed off on by them.
Zoning, yeah.
Okay, so this our approval isn't going to kick it back to them.
No.
They've already done that. Okay.
You seem like minor, Mr. Chairman. Me? I mean, unless somebody comes to me. Major change, which I don't
anyone
see.
Anyone here publicly here to speak for or against this one?
I would agree that there are minor changes, but I would like to see of energy that were promising years ago. That's neither here nor there.
Okay.
Minor. You know, the Harveys are pretty into that with their other sites, so then maybe they put them all elsewhere. I don't know. this won't change that opportunity.
Move to approve the minor site modifications as proposed by E.L. Harvey.
Second.
Okay, moved and seconded. Further discussion.
One question. The stormwater changes, is this the structures or the locations? It says roof runoff recharge system. Is that something the CONCON would need to also look into based on the location on the property? Or it's minor for us, but would that be...
Yeah, I don't know that it's in their jurisdiction. It's just because the trailer pit moving, so that kind of shifts things around. So it's just the how things are piped.
Same pipe, going the same spot.
They need to make accommodations
to get
there.
Gets around there a little bit.
Yeah. If it's in their jurisdiction, I'm sure they'll be here.
The good portion of it was, because I was in CONCOM for this.
But I don't know that this building is...
This building's all the way in the back on the Mass Pike area.
Right, that's where most of the wetlands are. Well,
no, they're further back. Well, I don't know.
Either way, I just have a question about it. I think either way it's minor, and if it's our thing or not.
Okay, so there's a motion and a second to approve the E.L. Harvey minor changes. All those in any further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay. Next off is Maspenock Woods. Do we have somebody that can explain what's going on with that?
Yes.
Oh. Good.
Unfortunately,
you should have said that you were from those guys up front, and I would have. You would have not wasted another 10 minutes of your life.
I didn't get here when they started this.
Okay.
Unfortunately, I'm here in lieu of Bruce and the guys who do the design for this, but this was the original Dean plan that was approved back, I guess, when you approved all the designs, and then this is the revised one in attempt to make use of the building envelope, especially off to the right, because each one of the building envelopes is a little different. So this is the new front elevation, which is somewhat similar to this front elevation, except for it has the two entrances. And then it on the sides it changes quite a bit.
Which is the old and which is
this
the new?
This is the old one.
Oh, that's the old, and that's the new?
That's right.
Oh, okay. I thought it was the other way around.
And this shows the walkout on the back, which I think that didn't really show as well. Half of it is shorter.
Why the reason for the change?
So they're trying to maximize the building envelope to get the best floor plan.
Wasn't there another room added?
I don't know. Honestly, I don't know that.
That sunroom on the side.
Was it added? Yeah. Okay.
Do you have a floor plan like similar to the old one?
I don't have a floor plan with me. Just
didn't we have that? Do we have that in our package?
I think it's in the package. Yeah, it is. It is in the second. Oh no, no, no. That's the old one. Wait a minute. Whoa. If I can just comment, like I know that design review a long time ago, spent a long time on that, and they haven't seen this. So, you know, I don't know what the board would think as a whole. Just on the surface, you know, I would say that the old one does look more like a box with stuff added, and this does have some more variations in the planes and the roof lines and, you know, few more architectural elements than the old design. So, you know, I don't find that objectionable, but I don't know whether it's enough of a this is just one of a number of units at Maspenock, right?
Yes,
aren't
yes,
there? There's a variety of styles.
Yeah.
And the other ones aren't changing.
The other ones haven't changed.
Yeah.
That I know. They approved an Emily plan. I think everybody approved an Emily plan a while.
Yeah. I don't know.
How many of these will be built?
Two. There's two of these.
And are they two single, double? What
these
are
two duplexes.
Duplexes. So two buildings, but four
units. Kind of across the street from each other.
Okay.
I have to think that we take the project as a whole, and which we have in the past. We looked at it, all the different variations of the styles and locations and how they were situated.
I did bring a site plan up there, if that's helpful.
It's been so long. I can't even remember what they all look like. I just wonder whether this is generally in the same vein as the other ones that are being built.
They all are pretty similar trim wise and feature wise.
Style cable.
So this is
yeah.
The location here.
Uh huh.
25, and the other ones right across the way.
Uh huh.
Those are the only two in the.
So then, Elaine, you basically just add that little bump out on the side. On the one unit gets a sunroom, because that's what I'm seeing.
Yeah, before it was just kind of a box, as Claire said, and now it's got some bump outs.
So basically, when you come in, you're going to see.
What's the front?
This one.
Where's the front?
You're going to see this at this elevation.
No, that couldn't be. That's a side.
That's a side, but you're going to see that right in here. Or
yeah, the back.
Every
room.
That's not labeled right. That should be labeled.
Yeah, top right one. Okay.
So where's the front door? Where does somebody come
in?
Beside the garage? Beside, so the garage
is
facing the driveway. That's your front.
Right. So it would be this one here that I see the changes here.
In the back, yes.
So that
there's two labeled.
Yeah, one's the left elevation.
One's the left and the right. Yeah, yes.
I think.
Rear.
Obviously front, because the garage doors are
well,
on the
Well, they've also, no, they haven't flipped them.
Couldn't they?
So it would be that one, I think.
I have the floor plan. Where's the, this is the back.
I think Ken had it right the first time.
We do have the full set upstairs, if necessary.
I think that first one is going to look better with that extra bump out to it. It's going to be more interesting.
It's this one here, right?
That one I don't care so much because you don't
see it.
You don't really see that one. And that one you're going to see
has the plans.
And you're going to see the rear also. And the rear, the right and the rear, whichever those are right, correct on the plan. All look pretty good.
If that's front, then that's right.
Here's the garage, and it's the right elevation here.
Is that right?
The deck and the stairs.
Yeah, there's your front door over there.
Mm-hmm.
The little post.
These two here.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
How do people feel, okay?
I think it's a little bit like Project Creep. You know, it's a little bit I have the back Dean building, like I agree with Ken, yeah, it's backside out of the way. You might see it from West Elm Street coming off of East Main, West Main. But the other one you see from the front gate itself might be...
I think that's positive that it's got more to it when you come in.
Because you got the loop all the way around that guy, kind of.
Yeah. Yeah, the other one you won't see because there's a bunch of woods right behind that. Yeah. You'll never see it from West Main.
And it is kind of a rocky hill to the right of it looking at it, so I just feel uncomfortable with changes of this sort. But is there a difference in square footage between the two different models?
You know, I don't honestly know that. I don't know the design.
I think it adds a room, a sunroom.
The sun pump on the sun, right?
Must be.
It's called a study slash sunroom. It looks like it's built of the same construction.
This is proper.
Oh, so it's on both units. One that goes behind the unit, the other one goes to the side.
That's 11 by 12 there. This one's 14 by 12.
So you're adding 100 something square feet. The assessor will get that much more tax money from them.
Right. What, they'll be able to sell for that much more.
What I'm seeing on this from a design standpoint is the problems that we've experienced with Legacy on the south parcel, where we have a lot of backs of buildings facing the road that are big expanses of clapboard without much window, without much detail. So what you see is a lot of clapboard. And this has the architectural interest of a variety of planes and windows and porches that do what the South Parcel Legacy did not do. And if you compare the old design that you had, on this old design you're seeing a much bigger expanse of just plain clapboard on both sides, whereas here you do have the added dimension of the extra windows, porches, so you're not having that same massive clapboard effect we've run into trouble with before. So, I mean, I think it's a good, totally acceptable.
There's not a lot of them in that sense, you know, that that bit back up to people's houses. Yep. You know what I mean, in the subdivision as well.
But it's punctuated with windows, which is important.
Is everyone willing to vote for this or not?
One more question, real quick.
Okay.
How many other changes might there be down the line? And that's what I'm concerned about as well.
I'm really not more of the construction. Bruce was on away, and I...
Construction started on some of these?
Started on two, and we applied for this permit. This was passed.
Thank you.
Move to approve.
Second.
Second. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone oppose?
Nay.
Is that enough?
Yes, that's enough.
4 to 5?
Mm-hmm.
4 or 5 is mm-hmm. enough on this one?
Yep, for this, yeah.
Oh, okay. Okay.
That's it?
You're all set.
Okay.
We'll write you the decision shortly. Okay.
Do you want me to leave one of these?
No.
Okay, master plan update. Who's got sections left to write? You?
Thank you. I'm dragging. Complete.
You're complete. I think Claire's complete.
Us?
Which sections are we missing?
We only have 2 sections.
2 out of 7?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's not good. We're going
to
have...
Ready to finish it up and get it ready for a public hearing once we do the writing.
We really want to get this done, and so it's time to...
I need to run. Is there anything else I need to specifically stay for?
Yeah, you have to vote on the Pulte extension. And if there's... I mean, lose a quorum.
We lose a quorum with you leaving.
Can't continue with the zoning hearing.
Okay. I'll stay. I just need to make a phone call then.
Okay. Next thing is the Southwest Advisory Planning Swap Committee appointment. Lane, do you want to explain that?
So, we're in the MAPC sub-region, as I explained in my memo, and MAPC region, and so they have divided all the communities up into sub-regions back in the early 70s, whenever it was created. And so the swap sub-region recently, through MAPC, revised the bylaws and clarified who should be representing towns on the swap sub-region. So I've been attending for years, off and on. I don't know if I was ever appointed, but I attended. Mary Pratt also attended for a time, but I think those are were the only two people who ever went regularly. And Mary attended as the MAPC representative. So the bylaws have been clarified, and so wanted to officially, you know, designate people by the town so that there are official representatives. So the Board of Selectmen appointed me to be its representative to swap, and the Planning Board has a seat available as well.
I'm concerned, confused, because you're in this first spot, and then the second one says one person employed by the planning community, and then it says only in the event the municipality does not employ such staff, and clearly we do. We employ a variety of people in that whole area, mm-hmm. So it would sound like we would be required, because we have those people, to put an employee in that second spot.
That's what it's saying.
So it looks like that has to be filled by someone within the LUP department.
Well, we are very fortunate. We have two planners on
right.
staff.
That's right. 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 So that's
if we were both representatives, we would take turns going, essentially.
So
yep.
I would entertain a motion to appoint Jennifer Burke as our alternate, provided that, what you say, provided she would take on that responsibility.
Sure.
Oh, man.
Second that, we agree you're a planner.
Wasn't sure. Yeah.
So, okay, it's moved and seconded. Let's have a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay, let's skip over town meeting articles for a second. Accept the resignation of Gail Fallon from the Design Review Board with our gracious thanks. She has moved out of town, so it's kind of...
We can send her a letter.
We'll send her a very nice letter.
I have to say a word for Gail Fallon, just for the board. Gail is one of four Design Review Board members who were part of the original group when the town put forth a request for Design Review in 1997. She has been loyal to that board. She has been very dependable on the meetings. She has been a really solid member, and she's not here tonight to hear that, but I do want to make that statement publicly, because we will miss her very much, and she will miss the board very much. She teared up when she told us she had to leave, so big yeah. thanks.
Write her a very nice letter.
No kidding. It was a little bit weepy that night. We all got a little teary about Gail.
Okay, look for a motion to accept her resignation.
So moved. Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote? Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone
no.
abstain? Motion carries.
I don't know.
No, you can't. And with acceptance of that, we are looking for a new member on the Design Review Board.
So we'll post that.
So we'll post that. If anyone knows anyone that would like to be a member of that, that's fine. Let's see. Where do I want to go? Let's continue the public hearing. So let's have some discussion first. This is going to be difficult. We're trying to come up with a date, maybe that we spend the whole day with Legacy, or maybe the whole day plus minus 15 minutes or something of other little business. We've not made much progress on that, but it's got to be a date where we're going to have a lot of people there.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, a lot of the people that aren't here today are people that have to say that they're going to be able to make that date. And then how do we propose to, do we have any dates that might be acceptable?
I could solicit, you know, from the other members here what dates they...
Where are people's thoughts about, let's say, next Monday? I think it was you, Elaine, that couldn't make it, right?
But you could meet without.
But Claire and I can't make it because we have design review board that night.
Was that when?
Next Monday we have design review board.
You on a Monday?
Yeah, remember we moved it for Jeff.
Well, I could miss design review to come to that.
Then I won't be here, and Elaine won't be here, and we won't have staff.
We need to, okay. So what was wrong with Tuesday?
We might need to move to
next Tuesday. I'm free.
We have Irvine today. I have Irvine Tadaro Properties Group meeting,
which there's no members other than you.
Right.
So
can I ask Jen what's on design review? I mean,
continuation of DPW.
I'm just wondering if that could get moved. I mean, this legacy really probably should take precedence over.
I can chat with both those people.
Tuesday would be an option with Jennifer.
Next Tuesday?
Yeah. You're out of town? Okay, that doesn't, you know, that's no fun. It's hot and humid, I think. You're gone the entire week?
Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday.
What's the following Monday? Is that our normal?
28. It's the regular meeting. Yeah. 28th.
The 28th? Mm-hmm. Well, why don't we go continue to the 28th, and maybe we'll try to get one after the 28th.
No, there's no meetings posted for that Wednesday either, the 30th.
I'm not available the 30th.
Okay.
Or the 31st.
Is
Tuesday 29th?
So Tuesday's open too.
Yeah.
How about the 29th?
29th.
We could do 2 days in a row.
Back to back.
Why don't we try that as a special meeting for the second one? But we'll on the 28th. What time?
Well, you have continued hearing for the MPSC.
Oh, that's our voice application.
At 7:30, and then you have 8:00 public hearing for the DPW.
So we could do this at 9:00, or we could do it at 7:30.
And start, you know, concurrent with
the master plan special permit.
We're not going to approve that until we approve this one.
And then you could, you know, pause it while you're with the DPW, and then come back
yep. to it.
Yeah, okay. And then maybe come back the following day. Make some real progress, or the following day we'll get that worked out. Okay, so looking for a motion to continue to 7:30 on the 28th of
March.
March.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. Okay, so this is going to March 28th at 7:30, and then 29th. Keep March 29th out open.
At 7:30 as well?
Well,
we should schedule it and then just cancel it.
Well, we'll probably keep it, and we'll, you know, we might go through, you know, our zoning master plan or something like, you know, we'll put in a bunch of hours. I mean, they're ready for a bunch of hours anyway.
So we better send a notice out to the members that aren't here tonight to let them know as soon as possible that there's enough.
Find out if the 29th works. Right now, we're not gonna schedule anything for that date.
Say it's tentative.
But we'll have a tentative schedule posted before that. Okay. Where are we? Okay, so got to that one. The process, okay, so the process, and I don't know whether I talked about it with the whole board, the transfer of the athletic parcel for legacy, if we want it to be anything other than open space and recreation, it's got to go through town meeting for a different acceptance vote. So if you want to do the Marathon Museum on that, and we've sponsored an article, but basically Roy is trying to transfer that as quickly as he can, maybe because he wants to stop paying taxes on it, but we the town, I don't think, are in a position to want to take it right now, the way it way we are constrained. So I just want everyone to know that we're kind of waiting on that. The other thing is we did receive a proposal from Beta and a kind of revised one for that right turn lane at Cumberland Farms / Starbucks, and the engineering price was high, and Elaine, with my concurrence, is going to go find somebody else. And if we don't find somebody else pretty quickly, then we need to pull the article from town meeting to accept that easement. So we still have planning board budget money that you can use without this board voting. So we're trying to get, as a minimum, the survey.
If I may?
Yeah, go
ahead. There's a land planner in Bellingham, Bill Hasley. And his son or son-in-law or something lives on West Main Street, okay. So he might be able to.
Sure, forward it to Elaine. I mean, we're always looking for some folks, but we've got a couple of surveyors that have done work for the town and quick work for the town.
Hoping to lose that.
Yeah. So that's. Anyone else have any future agenda items? I'm getting kind of ahead. I'm trying to remember what we had down here for discussing of town meeting articles.
I think which is something we're keeping on the agenda until town meeting.
Got it. Okay. Up. Well, then let's continue the public hearing on the zoning bylaw and zoning map amendments. We had started that off the last time around, and basically, Elaine, we've got a bunch of minor changes here in front of us, I think.
We have people here regarding the animal shelter.
Okay, well, let's do the animal shelter first. Come on down. Maybe I can find my pieces of paper here. Here we go. And animal shelter was about the second one into the pack. And let me go through it, and then I think I know where I heard where your comments are. So, if I got it wrong, let's go. I believe Elaine explained paragraph one. This is something Ray had put together.
It's a town council.
Town council decided to define it a little bit better using Mass General Law, but excluding the veterinary hospital or clinic. So that, and Mass General Law is written on the back of that so that you know what we're talking about.
So Zach used the MGL definition when writing this, so it's kind of, it's where it comes from. But and then kind of revised it.
Would that in any way constrain us if we wanted to have a health and wellness clinic in the shelter?
It says, may provide mission-oriented programs such as educational research, medical care, and on-site training programs.
Okay.
So I think
it's
the
same.
So the same language is still.
And then the only other change is the on-street parking. There was a paragraph that he was, or there's two other changes, but he wanted to get rid of the, there'll be no on-street parking as a requirement instead, because I'm trying to remember the rationale. You can't say no or whatever.
It's outside the zoning authority, and also the board is adopting a parking requirement in the same article, so it's really not
necessary. So basically we're putting a parking requirement so that they have parking as part of it on site, so that therefore that other part is not necessarily needed. And then the last change to that is the outside areas for animals being closed by a fence of a solid fence of at least 6 feet in height. And I believe that's where you got some suggestions. So why don't you make your suggestions?
Yeah, I'd spoken with Elaine earlier today about that, just in terms of wanting to allow for a little more flexibility in that section. Basically, you know, all the shelters that I visited, that, you know, there's a lot of chain link because there's people interacting with animals and animals interacting with animals, so you need to be able to see it. So we were just basically talking about if the stockade would be needed, how far, like if it is near a property line.
Can we have flexibility, I guess, so that the six foot solid fence is needed, for example, if the pen is close to the periphery of the property, but if it's internal to the property or the interior of the property, does it still need to be solid? Because usually you're trying to put animals in a pen and not have it be completely enclosed. And if it's a 6 foot pen, you really can't see what's going on in there. So there's a little bit of a safety issue at some point.
Ken, do you know where that solid thing came from? I mean, I've never seen a shelter that had
that
people in a, behind a wall.
That was Zach was concerned about neighbors and so forth and wanting to have some kind of a fence there if there was going to be a visual impact.
Well, it seems to me that if you did one of these facilities anywhere, you're going to have a good amount of setbacks, you're going to have screening, you're going to have noise buffer, you're not going to have these dogs right next to somebody's lot line. But I mean, that just isn't good for animals to have them in a box where they can't see out, and then how do people interact with the it doesn't make sense from an operational standpoint of the way you
it would be a safety issue. You can't just put animals in a completely enclosed
and you
pen
can't
and not
see them.
Able to see
no.
How about a compromise where the solid fence would be required on
lot line
on the lot line side, and then, you know, three sides of it would be open, or how could we write something like that, or no?
If the animal enclosure is within, you know, 50 feet of a property line or something, maybe you want a fence there, but if it's further than that away,
or maybe it shouldn't be the fence that the animal is penned in as much as just a fence along the border of the property.
Okay.
Well, I guess the question is, if you have a 5-acre property, do you really want a fence on?
Well, where there's an abutting, where there's an abutter.
Or any.
You know, there could be a change in abutters over time. Could be new homes built behind it. I think it'd be nice to have something
outside areas of the animals shall be enclosed by a fence of at least 6 feet in height, and the planning board may require the fence to be solid if needed to screen from abutters.
If the Board of Appeals be issuing a special permit. So this is a use by special permit. So we go through the Board of Appeals anyway.
Yeah, but I'm just saying it. Take the solid out and then put the.
So you could say, provided that the Board of Appeals may approve, I don't know, different arrangements based on site conditions or something like that. If you have a steep.
It seems to me that the issue at hand is abutters. And I'm not sure that it's germane to the animal enclosure. It's germane to adding some kind of screening for the abutters. I think that's what really needs to be addressed. As far as fencing for animals, for instance, if you put a stockade or any kind of wooden fence along the back of a dog pen, that dog's going to dig under that thing and be out in the first day.
Right.
Okay. You know, you can't secure a stockade fence the way you can.
How about, let's just start a new paragraph 7, I guess, that there'll be adequate screening from abutters. I mean, just put it that way as opposed to as a requirement.
Then the board can determine what's adequate.
Then the board can determine what was adequate. Because we have adequate control, odor control, you know, a lot of other things that are there. Just that way the screening can be done however it's best done. Okay.
So, are you
guys
take
happy?
Out, yes. Take out four.
No, four outside areas shall be enclosed by a fence of at least 6 feet in height.
Okay. but not solid.
That's fine.
Take the word solid out of there, yeah. And then add like seven, screening, which is why. There'll be screening of some, or, you know, put in zoning ease. Yeah. At this point, should we show, are people comfortable with this changes and are you ready to vote for it tonight?
I am.
Okay. It's possible.
Okay. I'd entertain a motion to approve the animal shelter wording for town meeting as amended tonight.
Second.
Move and second. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay. Since we got our dog experts here, cats, let's do doggy daycare next. Basically, they did the same thing with the, by taking the Mass General Law and putting it into that reference. We added an off-site parking requirement. One per three dogs, and let's see, this is a maximum number of how many dogs at doggy daycare?
12.
So basically, if you did 12 dogs, you're going to need four parking spots.
Based on, we had a dog daycare operator come and talk to Zach, and based on how she described, you know, drop-off and so forth, it seemed like that might be adequate.
Okay. And then, hours of operation, those are just kind of word changes, I think, right?
Yes.
What was Zach's rationale of not opening it on Saturday or Sunday?
That was a comment at the hearing mentioned about weekend. Zach talked about it, and I think they talked about it, and they thought, well, there might be some need, and maybe we'll still leave it up to the board kind of thing. So they didn't put anything in there, but they did discuss that it might not be good during weekends. So I don't think they have an issue with restricting it to weekdays.
You know, not before 7? Didn't we talk about 7 being awfully early?
Well,
if you're going to before work, it's not.
Yeah, I was going to say, if you're going for work. Yeah.
Well, I know, but
you're
maybe.
You're Boston, that's too late. You won't get to Boston.
But I'm thinking of what might pass or not pass on meeting. That's fine for the dog owner. But the people who live in the neighborhood who start to hear this noise at 7 o'clock in the morning, it's early. Perhaps if they want to be able to take the dogs in at 7, they have to be required to be able to keep them indoors until, say, 8.
So at number 5, yeah. I put that in to address that. I put before 9 a.m. the two dogs can be outside together.
Oh, okay. All right.
If somebody needs to go out or some dog needs to go out, they could go out.
Well, yeah, yeah. All right, that
the dogs are going to do what they're going to do. I don't care what
it is.
Well,
my first job was assistant animal warden for the city of Waukegan, Illinois, and I cleaned up my share.
Yeah. And you know, to that issue of weekend hours, I think if you started out with just the weekdays, people's biggest concern is going to be noise. And if it operates, and it operates nicely, and there's no problems, we could look further down the road to expand it to weekends if we can demonstrate that it's not a neighborhood problem. But, you know,
so you're saying leave it the way it's written?
I would. I think it has a greater chance of passing if it reflects some respect for the neighborhood.
Okay.
Till we know.
And there were people that when I attended that meeting, and there were people that were pretty adamant about that. So
this one's going to have a hard time getting
over
the fence, I think. But anyway, and item number 4, take the word solid out of it, which is the fence.
Yeah.
And then add
screen.
Add screening is number 9, maybe, or 10.
Mm-hmm.
11, I guess it's 11, T.
Yeah.
And the words that he changed for the special permit basically would look to me like kind of, you basically get a permit for two years at a time.
Yes, it wasn't legal to do the other.
Okay, well, we don't like to do things that are not legal. How do people feel about this one? Is it you're happy enough to pass it on as written?
Can I just ask, in that case, because it's a special permit, if sometime between in that two-year period it isn't operating satisfactorily, are they allowed to revoke the permit?
Yeah, so there's still zoning enforcement.
Okay,
yeah.
So they're not stuck for two years if it's horrendous.
Right.
And who checks that?
The zoning enforcement officer. So if there's a complaint, they'll go out.
Any other questions, comments? Ready to go?
Mm-hmm.
Entertain a motion to approve doggy daycare as amended tonight.
So move.
Second.
Ready for a vote, I see. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone oppose? Anyone abstain? Motion carried.
It's going to the dogs.
Yeah, that one. Remember that one, Elaine, because we'll put that one in my.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Yes.
Next one is hotel overlay district. The changes are really minor. This is, I don't think we heard too much for or against it at the hearing. This does change the map too, right?
No.
Oh, this keeps,
yep.
The other one changes the map.
Yeah.
So this is just a change to, on the second, on the back side is the changes that Zach's recommending. Change in the function space area, the terminology regarding the restaurant, and the health club changes to a fitness center.
So, in theory, because you have the hotel overlay district, which allows one unit on the west side of 495 and one on the east. Mm-hmm. If Elmwood Park Business District, which allows hotels as their own right, you could then have another one at that location, and you could have one on Lumber Street.
Mm-hmm.
So this potentially adds a third hotel to the equation.
You could also have one at Legacy Farms, too. So
okay.
It's one of the allowed uses there.
From zero to...
Okay.
Yeah.
What?
Not that they will ever come, but it's possible.
So if I read that, you couldn't have one at Legacy Farms.
Well, because that's written in the OSMUD.
It's written in the OSMUD, yeah. Exempting. Mm-hmm. It's not part of this.
No, it's not in the hotel overlay district.
Okay.
So this is just a small area around the interchange.
Got it. Okay. Comments, questions on the hotel area? Seeing none, are people ready to submit this to town meeting, this wording? Entertain a motion to submit it to town meeting.
Moved.
Second.
Moved, seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none.
Just a little discussion. So we are requiring a restaurant.
Mm-hmm. Just not called a full-service restaurant
anymore. Yeah. I mean, you know, fitness center, you can have a few pieces of equipment in a room, and they call that's the
right.
Fitness center.
Yep.
But a restaurant, some of these smaller hotels, you know, restaurant businesses are expensive to run, and the margin on food is small. And if you're located in an area where there are places to dine, you know, in reasonable distance, you know, gosh, Holiday Inn Express or stuff, they don't have restaurants on. Raising the bar too high?
No, they serve breakfast.
Would that count as a
restaurant?
Maybe it depends on how it's set up. It could be a zoning call.
I think the discussion we had earlier was the difference between Motel 6 and a place where you can have a function, even a smaller function hall than
The 1500 will probably stop the Motel 6 from.
That type, I mean.
Yeah. But maybe Holiday Inn Express doesn't meet that either.
Or Days Inn. I mean, I mean, like the Continental Breakfast thing, I could see that. But I don't know, does that mean restaurant? Restaurant sounds like you can go in and order food.
Sit down, or exactly. I think maybe they're thinking maybe a Starbucks or something like that.
Okay.
I'm just concerned. It seems to me that the objective of this was to kind of lower the bar a little so that we might actually attract somebody. And a restaurant, maybe food serviceability is one thing, but a restaurant seems to, I don't know, I'm just, I don't want to start it now because Zach's been through it, but it just seems to me that might be excluding some common change that, like, well, Days Inn or Holiday Inn Express.
I don't know if they wanted those two.
Yes, I think that's the question.
Well, Milton's got them all. They're eating up all the business that we're not getting.
Do you want a Motel 6 and what comes with it?
Yeah. I know, you can't specify.
Or do you want a
Red Roof or
a Marriott Courtyard, which does have a restaurant facility and what comes with it? So you can't differentiate based on level of pricing of rooms.
And you can't, and name either, but yet there are some nice chains, you know, like Comfort Inn or, you know. Well, we can give it a try, and so if we don't get anything, we'll take it out next year.
I mean, is the difference with the restaurant the continental, where you get your own, versus you go in there and you get served?
Right, how do you interpret restaurant?
I stay at a lot of hotels, right? I mean, I stay at Hampton Inn to the Hilton. A lot of them serve that continental breakfast. Pretty nice. They don't have a server, but they have someone who cleans up.
It's food serviceability.
Exactly.
Food service. Right.
And I think that you get into the medium level. It's above the Motel 6s, but it stays below the full Hilton paying $250 a night.
Mm-hmm.
That, to me, is the differentiation.
Yeah. And to me, a restaurant is where anybody can walk in and order something and pay the bill, whereas food service or continental breakfast is just, it comes part of your room.
Yeah, exactly.
It's just food service, but it's not a restaurant.
Do we have the term restaurant defined any place?
No, I don't think so. I don't think we do either.
Can it be defined?
Or should we just say food service?
Today.
Could you say just say food service.
Yeah, we use the term restaurants throughout the
At our next meeting?
Yeah.
Well,
are we running out of time?
Yeah.
We're running out of time.
We could work on that for next year.
Leave it restaurant and switch it next
year. We
already
use restaurant everywhere in the zoning already.
Okay. So, do I hear a motion to approve it as we've got in front of us?
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Are you guys ready for a vote? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone oppose? Anyone abstain? Motion carries.
Give it a shot.
Okay. The other one that was in our packet tonight, and we've got a few more after this, is the Elmwood Park Business District. Why don't you go through the changes that went through there? Most of them seem to be...
So the changes are responding to Town Council. On the first page, he suggested that we describe what low-impact development is, so that's how we describe it in Legacy Farms Design Guidelines, so I just put that same language in there. On the second page, Town Council just clarified, and G just clarified the language so that it reads more clearly.
Okay.
And there was a comment made at the hearing that, gee, why are we requiring a special permit for the dormitory component for a conference center but not for a hotel?
Yep.
So I took out the special permit requirement for a dormitory. So that's reflected in I on the second page and on the next page in the special permit section. And the other, I think that's it for the major changes. And then adding a Town Council suggested we define grocery store food market. So I put in a potential definition on page 5.
Okay. On page 5, the definition. Retail store primarily selling food as well as other convenience and small for consumption and use off premises. What if I've got the Starbucks that's built into the Price Chopper?
Well, you're not consuming the grocery food there. There's a separate outlet there that's selling you something to consume while you're shopping or, you know, while you're there in the store potentially. Mm. But you're not buying the grocery food and eating it there.
It says primarily.
Mm-hmm. Well, restaurants are allowed in the district by right. So you could say that part of the building's a restaurant, and
yeah, you can have a mix of uses together.
But the fact that you've got primarily, that seems to be an out that you could have some sort of secondary use. It doesn't absolutely prohibit it,
yeah,
but
like
primarily.
A bank.
Or yeah. Starbucks, but mm-hmm.
yeah.
primarily
mm-hmm.
it's
okay. I don't want to permit, you know, prohibit that through that. I just want to make sure that people that are writing the.
Did you guys skip over the 4-5, making 4-5 on page 3?
4-5. Yeah, we took out the conference center.
Renumbered.
That's just a renumbering.
Ken, you just want to start eating those chips before you get out the door.
What chips?
You want to put your hand in the bag of chips before you get out the door.
No, not me. I don't eat chips.
Eat it on the premises.
I want to eat healthy food. I'll steal the grapes.
Pick them up.
Okay. Are we ready to go forward on Elmwood Park business? The other part of it is, go ahead.
You asked me to follow up with reaching out to the property owners. So there were 3 property owners there, sent them all letters. I didn't hear back from them formally. I did see Finn Perry at the library groundbreaking, and I asked him what he thought about it. He said he's fine with it. He just wishes there was residential allowed. But he's,
I've never heard that
he's
before.
Fine with it. And he said he had talked to the new owner of the couple of parcels in the back, and they didn't have any issues with it either. So. Didn't hear that from them directly, but that was what he
that should be left open because I'm in contact with them now. So I think they have something to say about that. But
well, they
their opportunity is
narrowing.
Well, they can speak out the town meeting.
They just bought the building on the 2nd.
Are we ready to advance this?
Might throw a glitch into it, Lauren, sure. We discussed before. I had the discussion, and we have one of the adjacent property owners, had a discussion with people who do this around the country. And one of the comments that came back was, by not including any of the frontage properties on Main Street, we might want to, we're limiting what somebody is willing to risk to do it. Because the ability to do a comprehensive plan and a development, it would be severely restricted by not having frontage on Main Street and having the access around it. Because we don't bring it.
Can you define that, please?
In other words, the many people who do this type of development want frontage on the main road, mm-hmm. which would be Main Street.
Right.
We don't
West
have
main
that.
Street.
West Main Street.
Right. So this would add Cliff's property?
The empty lot, the mobile station, and the small office building.
Which are not longer, not in the property now.
Yeah.
And I was under the stipulation that if I so deemed on my property that I could be included into that from what I've been told. If the rezoning goes through, I could request to be included in the rezoning.
Well, right now...
The rezoning doesn't specify that. Zach was only proposing to change the zoning of the industrial B zone portion and nothing beyond it. So that's not included, and it hasn't been advertised that way. So we have to if we were going to include additional property. But you're having a hearing anyway on April 11th. We could include it.
Well, the question.
May I ask?
Yeah, go ahead.
Would that be under request from the property owners, or would that be insistent upon the change?
All zoning has to be voted by town meeting, so it's not a request. It has to be voted by town meeting.
Okay.
So if you want your property rezoned, you have to ask somebody, and right. It has to be advertised and then go to town meeting for a vote.
For clarification to the chair, for the other side of that question, and no one else could ask to rezone your property either. That's what I'm asking.
Somebody could. In the town, you know, you could propose that.
But
I think Zach was really concerned about revitalization of the existing industrial park and not necessarily a larger area of development. They were only concerned about redevelopment of an existing area, and they really didn't want to go beyond that.
Perhaps given the short time frame and the fact that this has already had a fair amount of vetting, the cleaner way to do it would be to keep this as it is and move it ahead and then look back. Should we look to, if this goes through, should we look to expand that zone at a subsequent town meeting to include more, taking into consideration the arguments that John has presented? It's getting a little late to start adding properties. I'm just thinking that might be the easiest way to do it.
That again, Claire, that was in discussion on my behalf that I knew of, that when it came down to that situation, if it was going to be rezoned, that the proposal would be that we make my land inclusive in that, if it was to benefit that that aspect or not. So I still don't see what everything is going to look like yet, and that's what concerns me about either keeping it the same or making John's proposal as to incorporating it. So I'm still in the air on both understandings.
It looks like right now where things stand, it's strictly the existing Elmwood Park here. Mm-hmm. They didn't expand the district.
So they were just interested in redevelopment.
Right. And what would happen if you decided at a future date, it would be a separate rezoning of your parcel going to town meeting and getting approval that way. There's no way to necessarily piggyback without going to town meeting on the adjacent zone.
Once it's established.
Well, once it's passed a town meeting.
Right. So now my question is, can someone give me the differentiation between the zone that they're looking at and the zone commercial B that is presently existent, rural B?
Rural business.
Rural business for your property?
Yes.
Yeah, I had done a comparison for Zach for the industrial B because that's what this is, but I haven't looked at that. I think there's a greater difference between the two because, rural business it has its own kind of character. It was designed to be next to neighborhoods and kind of low key, where this district has a height requirement that's much higher, greater intensity of use. So that's something to really consider.
Your property, unless it was combined with a whole bunch of other ones, would be very difficult to put any of this stuff onto.
And it would be undersized. I don't think you have 45,000 square feet.
No, I'm in the process of making some changes on that. So there's something going on there.
I think you might be better off waiting, and see where it goes.
There's no development proposal right now to look at. There's not going to be anything to look at.
But I mean, looking bigger picture, as John has suggested, it might be an appropriate exercise for Zach next year to start to explore, should we apply the same thing to the office building, Cliff's property, and the vacant lot on the other side to get Main Street frontage included, and do it as another whole piece that Zach puts forward next year if it makes sense, and give it the full vetting and public hearing.
I do know that Tom Nealon would like to be privy to this conversation as well, if he were, because he's attended every meeting that we've come to so far, and he's walked out of here steaming on almost every occasion. So I don't know. Again,
He's in even a tougher situation, in that it's almost impossible to add more to his little parcel that would kind of make any sense.
And he hasn't expressed a desire to be included, hasn't offered comment at all during the ZAC process. So.
Yeah. Okay. Well, is there a consensus that we're ready to pass this one forward?
I'll make a motion.
Okay, it's been moved to submit this one to town meeting as is currently written. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion?
I'd just like to see more clearly in this, as this is going forward to town meeting, is more where it physically covers, or so saying Elmwood Park Business District, it is kind of open to presentation, where I thought it did cover.
I did distribute the map for the last meeting. I didn't.
The map comes with this one.
In writing,
That's my only concern, but...
Well, it lists the assessor's...
There'll be a map for town meeting.
Yep, and it does list the assessor's map.
On page 5.
On page 5 at the bottom, it talks about the assessor's maps.
Okay.
Okay.
But,
are we ready for a vote?
Yes.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries.
And just my point was, like, yeah, those addresses, I wasn't sure what address is which, and I heard about the pool company being sold, and I wasn't sure which building it was, so...
Okay. In the interest of time, we still got signed, so I'm going to take that one last. We have garden apartments in residential districts, village housing in residential districts, repeal the senior housing bylaw, and we have the site plan review bylaw. These are basically unchanged from the last time we had the hearing. And we didn't have any real feedback comment on any of those.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Town council.
So I'd take a motion to approve those four items.
Mm-hmm. As one, discussed.
There are no changes.
I move that motion.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. Okay, the next one was an open space and landscape preservation district bylaw changes. This is the one that's going to be subject to our public hearing on the 11th.
Right.
But we're going to have words before that.
There are words. That you'll review at the public hearing. Well, it's basically, it changes in the table of uses in the OSMUD. There's a list, there's a use called culture uses, which includes museums and the like, and it will go from a special permit to, it will go from a no in this residential sub-district to a by right.
So basically we're allowing museums and cultural, so it's a fairly simple wording change.
It's already on the warrant.
And we'll explain that to everyone that's the Marathon Museum. And that one will pass through.
Well, I just got to ask about that. I mean, it's the Marathon Museum, but if you make that by right, what's to, musical concerts, musical events are cultural events. What's to prohibit someone from opening a coffee house music club thing with,
like
concerts?
Like a jazz.
So at the hearing, you can discuss whether it should be by right or by special permit.
Yeah.
Yep.
Honestly, some of the debate that's going on right now with the selectmen and the liquor license for the Cultural Arts Alliance,
let's put it by special permit and just cut the argument out.
I'd start to get nervous.
And that way, nobody will fight that at all.
Just checks and balances.
Mm-hmm. Right. And the Marathon Museum will get there.
We could intend one thing, but it's broad enough that a whole lot of other things could jump in on it, and it's by right, you're done.
Okay, so the OSMUD change for cultural events by special permit.
Okay.
We don't call out the athletic parcel. That's considered a residential parcel?
It's in the residential sub-district.
Okay.
So.
And the only other...
Lumber Street, you mean?
Yeah. No. Legacy Farms.
Oh, okay. Okay, so entertain a motion to advance to town meeting the open space and landscape preservation district bylaw changes to allow cultural... And whatever by special permit.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. Okay. Now, I think the last one is signed by law.
Yeah, you distribute some comments from the camera.
We have a lot of comments. So we got comments from Rita today, and we got a bunch of changes. So let's just quick go through the paragraphs and kind of explain it, and then Elaine, why don't you tell me where Rita, as we go, let's go through.
So I think pretty much most of the changes that you see here are town council's wording changes, further reading the bylaw of content references. So that includes the purpose section. He's recommending those changes. And everything else that's on that first page is for clarity or for content.
Okay, I had one further change to that. Sandwich board signs, two identical flat surfaces. If you make a sandwich board, potentially one side is smaller than the others because otherwise you don't get the supports to fit together necessarily, depending on how you do it.
Yeah.
So I'd take the word identical, and if somebody has a sandwich board, maybe they want to do roast beef on this side and chicken on the other. Any other comments, questions on the first page? We're going to the second page.
More of the same. Clarity of language.
But they also kind of, you know, they leave out, you know, for sale signs or for rent, whatever. I mean, there's all sorts of, there are some uses in this paragraph.
Because there is a few uses that in the dissenting opinion or one of the opinions of the Supreme Court, they specifically called out real estate signs. So they believe that real estate signs could pass the test of being okay.
What about political signs?
Well, we've addressed that later.
Somewhere else.
We addressed it.
We're getting to that. It's on the next page.
We addressed it, but not nicely.
Not explicitly.
Now, we have not changed any of the sizes of these.
There's only two instances, so I'll point those out when we get there.
Okay. So does any, on page two, are people happy with what you're reading? Why don't you start us on page three?
On page three, J is for clarity.
Yeah, but how about H? Is that where Rita is?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, so that's where Rita is talking about.
Rita, okay.
So I think it seems to be I don't know, and Jen can probably talk about this too since she's attended Designing Board and Claire as well, but there seems to be a confusion over the terminology and what is meant. So I had two emails from Rita, and one was her earlier one that enclosed some photographs of various signs to illustrate what she was talking about. She had provided those photos. So I think the way it's worded now was the words that came from the Design Review Board. That's what's proposed. And so basically it would prohibit the internally illuminated box signs and any other sign that's internally lit.
Do we want to add the word internally illuminated and put the word box in there?
Yeah.
Box or panel?
In this confusion of what is backlit. So.
Because like channel lit, I mean, this light source is still in the back, but it's okay because it's coming through the carved channel of the letters.
So I guess I was confused, I think.
I was confused.
As whether the channel letters are those individually lit letters.
That's a channel too. Letter.
Yeah.
There's a channel letter and a channel lit letter. So that's where we get the confusion because half the design review board talks about one thing and half
I know.
Can I make a clarification on channel lit?
Sure.
All right. So if you made a gusset around your sign and put lighting inside of that to illuminate the sign without any direct rays of light, so that would be a channel lit sign. Mm-hmm. Does everybody understand what that means?
What is a gusset?
A gusset is just like a if you build a little box like this up and left an inch of exposure and put a lighting inside that all the way around the room. The room would be illuminated through the ceiling opening. Would be illuminated enough to.
But how does it light the surface of what's in front?
By reflection of the light through the gusset.
It's a box.
It's like a box. It's just like a. An L shape that you put lighting into, and that will illuminate the sign without casting out light towards any source.
But unless it's coming through a surface, how does it light?
It's not coming through a surface. It's an open space.
You can see the light itself.
You'll only see the light, not the light.
So you're talking about like the Unibank sign.
No.
Because those are backlit.
Yeah.
That's backlit, yeah.
Yeah, those are backlit.
That's similar.
I don't know if we have any channel.
Same thing, but...
What is it, channel lit?
I think these individually lit letters, like looks nails, I think those are channel lit.
No.
No?
Those look... And that's what Rhea and I disagreed at the other meeting. Those are lit internally.
Right.
They're channel letters, but they're lit internally.
Right.
Which is what the... Since I've been here, and granted it's only been since June, but that's what the board has always said they did not like.
I'm still so confused. And I'm on that damn board.
If we cannot define this, so
that
a layperson is, it's just, we're not going to get what we think we want to get.
You know, you could just say signs, you know, internally illuminated signs are prohibited. But what do you need to say?
We just approved a few of them, I think.
I
like 110 grill. It's lighting behind. And look what Golden Pond's got. That's like a channel type thing where the letters are carved and light comes through the opening. The whole thing isn't
that's
illuminated, just the letters. That is internal.
Right.
But it's the letters as opposed to a box sign. And 110 grill, there's a light source and the letters are on top of it, so you get that, what they call halo lit.
Right.
You just get a glow around it.
So look, if everybody looked at that for 1 second.
Yeah.
Okay, everybody see that? Up inside this little channel right here would be lighting.
Yeah.
And the illumination would be focaled onto the sign itself, but not coming out towards you. So you don't get blinded by a light. You're only getting the light reflective inside that channel to illuminate the sign. That's called a channel lighting. Does everybody understand that?
Yeah.
And that's it's
but that's not backlit either.
No, it's not backlit.
No, that's
channel lit. Well, Unibank
is backlit.
Backlit because they've got the light coming.
They're on the back
yes.
of the letters, and they face yeah. the wall, and it halos the sign.
Yes,
the letters.
Mm-hmm. But the inside tower portion is
well. That's a whole.
That's
a
whole.
That's a whole.
That's
yeah.
Not a sign.
Yeah, that's not a sign.
Don't talk to Claire about that tower.
Yeah,
him about it. Red, blue, green.
Right. I mean,
I think it's terrible.
I think it's terrible too.
We talk to them. They. Care.
But
the ministry
who permitted that anyway?
Nobody.
Nobody. They never told us there were going to be colored lights.
They took their own liberty on that?
It's interior decoration.
It is. Well, maybe we should ask Rhea to just tell us how we should word the can
well,
she make
she
did. She did.
This isn't any more clear to me what her wrote in her email.
Channel lighting is a very good light, believe it or not. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't cast out the way that a backlit light or a placed light on a sign does climb up, you know what I mean? So a channel light is good and it's subdued. I've been told by Ken, I mean,
okay, what did we say?
By
DPW.
John Westling, that, you know, to have signs that are lit up can cause a distraction in your eyes for cars coming and going. So the reason for the channel lighting would be just to stop that direct lighting to dim it down.
So we think we have a solution.
Okay, go ahead.
So if it says signs may be backlit or channel lit, period.
Yep.
Internally illuminated signs are prohibited.
Yes.
Internally illuminated panel signs.
Box
yes.
and panel.
Box
and
panel.
Box
and
panel.
But
people know what a box sign is.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
That sounds good.
That sounds good.
And can we maybe, we'll have another chance to look at this, right? I mean, I
no,
wonder if we should.
No.
Well, you can make changes
yeah.
and tell me if
no, I just
don't
didn't know whether.
Yeah.
No, I don't. I just. Rhea works in the industry. I didn't know whether maybe, you know, she should weigh in on that. I mean, it's just. We need to talk the language
let's,
that the people come into.
Let's keep going so we can get this done. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I know.
I think it's real close, Claire.
Yeah. Do you have no
okay.
motion to accept the new wording?
No, let's go through the next couple pages here.
Right.
So everything else on that page is just clarity by town council.
Okay. On page 4, doesn't A1B, are those all content type stuff?
apparently you're allowed to limit off-premises signs. So that's their reference to off-premises signs. So they say that's acceptable.
Okay.
And then in 2A, that's where Zach had proposed a reduction in the square footage of wall signage.
Yeah.
So I highlighted Zach's 1.0 and put it back to the 1.5 it currently is today. Discussion about it. Mm.
Yep.
What page do you want to go?
Page 4, item 2A.
I think we try to make this is what we're doing for for the Supreme Court, and not talk about changes in sizes and stuff mm-hmm. like that, and just try to just say, hey, this is a Supreme Court driven decision. I mean, I personally, and I've told Elaine a lot of times, the height of the standing signs are 10 feet. I think that just makes it so you can't drive and see under them, you know. But I'm willing to forego playing with that. Mm-hmm. Where else are we changing sizes?
There's a real estate sign change. I think it's in the industrial district that gets larger.
Okay. We're not taking anything away from anyone. Okay.
Sure.
So
I like that.
Everything else.
Wait a minute. What's F on 4?
It's referred to the special permit section that's at the end of the section of this bylaw. So
don't we have that provision already?
It's already there. So they're just pointing to it. It's more clear to say that than it says, you know, to the maximum extent practical. I think that's what town council is getting at. I think they're proposing that for clarity.
Where is it? Where are you saying that it's pointing to where?
Section 180B is here, just later on. It's at the end of the bylaw.
A2B.
So it's the special permit provision?
Okay, yeah.
On the bottom of page 5.
On the bottom of page 5.
Where the Board of Appeals can approve signs which are different than this by special permit.
Oh, okay, yeah.
That's the safety valve.
Mm.
That's good.
So that's there today.
Okay, so, and page 5 is just wording changes?
That's right, but I think, did we skip over the temporary signs for political?
That was on page 2.
Yeah, so page bottom of page 3.
Yeah.
D and E are new. And that's how Zach decided, you know, town council gave them a couple of options and, you know, ways to deal with marathon and political signs.
See, I don't see the marathon signs as what the requirement is for that area. I don't know how you know, I mean, are we talking about banners on streetlights, I guess, or street posts?
Well, they're basically you're giving people 30 days where you can have larger signs, up to 24 square feet.
Okay. And the great, or the number one Ash Street probably doesn't even meet 24 square feet.
Right, so they already have a special permit.
Got it. So. Okay. And then E is allows me to put as many signs in my front yard as I want.
That's right. All right, okay. So back to page 5.
So I think we're okay with the rest of 5.
Yeah, in the industrial district, I'm pretty sure that's where the size of real estate signs went larger.
Okay. And we can still get away in the adult entertainment?
Yes, because adult entertainment is different.
Okay. We'd want to get away with it.
And same with the registered marijuana, since there's a separate statute on that.
Okay.
These regulations come from.
Okay.
I have a question. For the registered marijuana dispensary, where it's a medical thing, can we limit, not have graphics in front of signs for that? Is that something that we'd be interested in?
How do you speak?
Well, I think there's a lot in there already. This comes right from the...
From Mass Law.
The regulations.
But
So what I'm wondering, what I'm trying to avoid is
leaves.
Yeah, graphic images that if someone is there for medical reasons, then they can read a sign and they know how to find a business. And I think it'd be more acceptable to someone who's totally against pot anyways, to be less, it's less intrusive if it's a signed medical dispensary office as opposed to having a pot leaf or something commercial looking. It's not really a commercial location. Mm-hmm. It's a medical location, and that I'm just wondering, you know, like Shields MRI doesn't.
It's a content.
Yeah, I think that gets into content and message.
I think
yeah.
I'd leave
coffee
it
cup,
subject
yeah.
to their.
Leaf, yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Throw that out there.
And then
non-conforming signs stays the same. It's just worded for clarity. Same language that town council has used elsewhere.
Okay.
Cutting me off premises.
Are we ready to advance signs? Those entertain a motion.
I just.
Oh, okay.
I'm sorry. I just did this, because I wanted to ask this last time, and I'm not sure if this covers it or not. Does this cover, or should we have something that covers, signs that are just abandoned? Does this protection set forth shall terminate with respect to any sign that has been abandoned? Mm-hmm. So it the protections. But is
you
there
can
anything
abandon
that
for 6 months and then you're done.
But is there anything that allows or requires the building inspector to require an abandoned sign to be removed? I mean, we've got some around town that the places no longer do business, and they don't have any protections, but they also are allowed to just leave their rotting sign there.
Mm. So they could take action if they receive a...
Who could
notice.
Take action?
That it's only enforcement officer that... So
if they receive a complaint
yep.
that there's
they
a sign that's been abandoned, that they're no longer doing business, this allows...
They could use the current bylaw.
The current yeah. bylaw does. Okay. Yeah. All right. Because I wanted to make sure that there was something that provided that.
I can see this could be confusing. There's like a bookstore and another store. But it's also kind of charming, too. I'm tired. I'm right.
Okay. entertain right. a motion to... Advance the signed bylaw to town meeting as the wording were changed tonight.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay. Entertain a motion to close the public hearing for zoning bylaw and zoning map amendment.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. I think that concludes the business, unless you had anything more under correspondence or anything. Anyone have any future agenda items, please see me or Elaine, and we'll take care of it. Thank you all for coming and staying so late. I apologize if we went over 25 minutes. Look for a motion to adjourn.
I'll move.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those who want to continue to stay here, you're on your own.
Are you any relation to Dan Dan?
Dr. Motion Dan? The meeting is adjourned.
Five North Attleboro?
No. Yeah, but I mean,
there's possibility, but you don't know.